Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan. We now return to our interview with Pat McNary, where we discuss so many Orcs Unlimited projects that he has going on. Enjoy. So I do want to talk just a little bit about some of the other things that you have going on, too. So, for instance, Ink, we had mentioned just a moment ago. Where is Ink in process at the moment?
So Ink is done. Okay. Is in editing and then page layout. Page layout takes way longer than you'd think it does if you've never laid out a book before.
Right.
So, especially role-playing games, because there's so much secondary art and charts and elements and everything else. So we're most likely mid-next year we're looking at for Ink at this point. So that's kind of where we're at with that. And it's kind of our magic punk fantasy, giant flying ships and ornithopters and evil ink bad guys game. This is our first really big game. It's going to be, I believe we're looking at 300 and something pages when completed.
Nice. That is a fairly big game.
It is a big game. The art is just fantastic. It cost me a fortune.
That's how you know it's good.
Yeah, for an independent game developer, over the course of a couple of years, I've slowly, one piece at a time, been collecting this art from some amazing artists. And when we get our site up for all the Ink stuff, I have all the names and places you can go to talk to these artists.
Nice.
But that's probably early next year. We have a couple of card games that are really close. They're in test play right now. To follow up with Space Pirates, the musical, our any nominated game.
Mm-hmm.
We are doing the final follow-up to it, I hope. We'll see. If you didn't know, we also made Barbarians the musical, which was supposed to be the last of the musical line games, because no one wants to go to the well too many times. But my oldest daughter really wanted to see Zombie Apocalypse the musical, is in editing and should be ready for page layout, and is a 20-page game, so page layout will take little to no time for. So we'll probably see that right around the end of this year. And the card games will kind of depend as the art comes in. We're hoping for Gen Con releases, maybe.
Okay.
For card games, Dodgeball, the role-playing game, is in its final phases of test play. So we'll go to editing soon.
Okay.
So yeah, we don't do one game at a time around here.
You do six.
Yeah, we always have a backlog of multiple games. So I think we're looking at 10 games right now in some form of production or other. We've also partnered with This End Up Publications, and they're going to be doing, I'm going to be doing some of their role playing games on the side because I have so much side time. So I'm working on some of the ideas with some of them over there. And we're doing some of our fiction, the fiction for Small Wardens, our game that isn't Chippendale's Rescue Rangers, because I would get sued if it was, but it's similar.
Dale.
Yeah.
It's not chipmunks, right? Is it some other kind of woodland creature?
It's a bunch of woodland creatures. It can be
numerous
rodents as you save the world. It's a fun little game, but we had some fiction done for it, and I have a fiction through This End Up Publications.
Okay. So it's not like a Brian Jacques sort of thing at all. Please, Brian Jacques, don't get angry.
Yes, please. Don't. So, yes, it harkens back to those afternoon cartoon days, but they're...
Sure.
It should be distinct enough that Disney won't sue me. Please don't sue me.
I don't know how valuable property Chip and Dale are to Disney at this point.
Well, they seem to not really care.
that is true. That's why Mickey's still not in the public domain.
Exactly. So it's similar to those those type of there. I mean, there were the Chippendale wasn't the only type of that cartoon, but it's similar to those adventure cartoons with small woodland creatures from the 80s and 90s. So it's similar to that. We did a group of short stories that are based upon a group of characters in that world that are private investigators and how they solve crimes, big and small. It's a real fun short story. And the audiobook comes out mid-November. Those'll all be fun. Longtail PI, if you're interested, is the name of the book. It's available on Amazon.
Longtail PI.
Yes.
So I solve crimes?
Yes.
Ooh.
So it's a crime-solving rat and his squirrel partner.
That just sounds squirrely.
Yeah, a little squirrely to me.
Once upon a time, I wrote some stories about a mouse that liked to solve crimes.
Oh, see?
Yeah, it was a detective. Because I kind of like the idea of like a detective that was small enough that they could like crawl through vents and stuff.
So, yes, right. Rev, those available should be Audible mid-November. So we've had a lot of good stuff coming out, more every day. So whenever I hit my head, something new happens. So,
right.
How often do you hit your head?
More often than I'd like to tell anybody.
But please, in great detail, tell us exactly how many times we've hit your head. Now you have a game for Mimicorns.
Mimicorns? We'll have to do Mimicorns now?
Yeah. I see it as kind of like a jousting game.
Oh, see,
you know, like the Mimicorns trying to joust each other, but like who will actually eat each other?
Ooh,
reveal
I like
that they'll,
who,
they're a who mimic.
Gets to, who gets to actually eat the other mimic?
Yeah.
The bigger mimic. The fans of our existing games will be doing add-ons for Bugs and Teddy Bear Island before the end of the year as well. So it'll be a new Big Russ's Big Book of Gear to go along with Big Russ's Big Book of Bugs. Fluffamancer's Guide to Plushies for Teddy Bear Island should be out. All should be out before the end of the year. So
what? Okay. Wait, Fluffamancer?
You have not heard of the Fluffamancer?
So you haven't played Teddy Bear Island yet?
Oh, no,
I can't have nice things, Nathan.
I haven't.
So a Fluffamancer is a character that controls the evil plushies on Teddy Bear Island.
Oh.
And so this will be the Fluffamancer's Guide to All Said Plushies on Teddy Bear Island.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So I believe it adds 40 new plushies to the game. So I think there was 12 in the original publication, 3 in the follow-up Return to Teddy Bear Island, and this will be 40 more, which will leave you with an ungodly number of evil plushies to swallow your soul.
Are all those plushies bears, or are they other various
adorable plush friends?
Oh, so that might want to eat you?
Yes.
Oh, good.
Adorable plush friends, they're gonna eat your soul.
This is this is Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, the game.
There you go. This is beautiful. So that should leave us close to 60 plushies that inhabit Teddy Bear Island when we're done with this set. It's not quite the monster manual, but it should get you there.
I feel like at some point, like the whole like setting of Teddy Bear Island has to become like one of those horror survival games that everyone always plays to get scared.
Exactly.
Like you just end up on Teddy Bear Island. You have no weapons or anything, and all of these deadly plushies are trying to kill you. You have to hide.
We have a possible pilot for a television show for Escape for Teddy Bear Island in the works.
Oh, cool.
It would be a Archer or Star versus the Forces of Evil style of cartoon.
Oh, yeah.
Not Evil Concarne?
Maybe. It's similar. Kind of. We're going to do the try to keep to the two 12-minute shorts in an episode format. And we're talking to a couple of people, but kind of hoping for maybe a Netflix or FX type of pseudo adult, but still not as adult as Archer. So your 12-year-old could possibly watch it type of show.
Yeah. I mean, it wouldn't be hard to keep it a little more PG than Archer.
Well, yeah, that would be. So that's also in the works, but that might be I have to come up with some funds to pay some people. So,
but right.
We have a couple of scripts for the first couple episodes, and we're talking to some people. So that might be a thing in the next, in 2019, 2020.
Oh, very cool.
There's a lot of stuff going on.
Well, we're always, again, every time I hit my head, so that gives you some general idea of how I play in my head.
So yeah. Just pay someone to smack your head every couple minutes.
No, you don't need to pay anybody for that. Trust me, as somebody who has smacked his head more times than I care to remember, you do not need somebody to outsource that job to. You could do that in-house.
When you say more times than you can remember, is it because you
I can't remember
because of the head injuries?
I cannot remember from the amount of times that I've hit my head.
Pretty much. That's the way it comes out.
Yeah. That's why no one can actually accurately remember how many times they've hit their head.
We will also be producing my oldest daughter's first game next year. It'll be one of our card games about building your own arcade. It'll be kind of 80s based.
Oh, neat.
She's super excited about it. We've worked on the art with her. She is working we're going to have test play copies out next month. So we're really excited about that one too. So.
Very cool. You know what? You know what you can do since you want to try to work with the Netflix, right? Is you know, they have an 80s series called Stranger Things. You could try get it Stranger Things brand, and if it's like cards, there could be a literal upside down. Like you turn it around and it's the arcade cabinet in the upside down, and there then yeah. See, well, you get the base game, and then. You know, if you end up, you know, needing to do some cross promo, you have the Stranger Things edition. And then it's, you know, that's just another version that people get to buy down the road.
Yes, like Edna Karopoli.
Yes, absolutely.
My favorite Monopoly version.
What do I do in that version of Monopoly?
I don't really know, but it was my favorite Simpsons episode, so I always remember it.
Oh, endocrinopathy. Yeah, that's good. You know what? It's better than proctolomy.
Can't even say it.
Yeah, proctolomy.
Exactly. It's like, hey, I want to buy your polyps.
Proctolopy. Yeah, there you go. Proctolopy. Yeah, there you go. That's perfect. That was a really shitty game.
Ah.
So, yeah.
That's bad. Just stop.
I guess I am the butt of that joke.
Yeah. Oh, that's the game that we could make. Monopunally.
Oh.
Monopunally.
I think I heard a door close. Did somebody leave?
Nope. We're done here.
Alex is just like, okay, I'm out. I'm done. Monopunally is where we end. We never come back after Monopoly.
You would call it Dadopoly.
Dadopoly. And then, I have so many good dad jokes. I was going to put them in a game.
That can be all the cards for where Chance and Community Chest would be. It's just different kinds of puns, and you have to read the puns out loud if you want to get the bonus. You have to read the jokes.
And you have to do it without groaning.
So the game is you have to win dad's favor by laughing at his jokes.
Ah, I like
find him actually funny.
So instead of houses and hotels, you have the little stand-up mics or something, because dad's trying to be a comedian, and you have to collect all of those on little spaces.
Essentially.
No one wants that game, but someone will play it for the same reason people play terrible games like Quap.
You say terrible, but you still played it. Under duress.
I played it under duress. Every crappy game that I have played, I feel like has been pretty much under duress.
I feel that many games are played under duress.
The game of life.
For instance.
Literally.
It's my least favorite game.
Yeah.
Especially when it's wake up and go to work time.
Oh, man. And what was with that little spinny wheel? That was annoying.
I think that's usually the load button, isn't it?
That's because you're using a Mac, Nathan.
Why is this loading?
It's loading, dude. Yeah, no, that little spinny wheel. Boy, it's amazing that that wasn't used for more board games after that one. The little Wheel of Destiny.
Yes, Wheel of Destiny.
For some reason, people were like, no, we like dice and cards more.
We like things that don't suck. Thank you very much.
We don't like things that are dependent on just how sticky the little grommet is under the little wheel. It only makes sense with things like if you're playing like Wheel of Fortune, but as a board game, because that's like in the actual Wheel of Fortune.
Board. Oh, fortune.
I'd like to buy a vowel. Okay. Just go to your refrigerator, get the magnets. That's all. Wheel of Fortune, the RPG.
Wheel of Fortune, the RPG.
Yeah.
Man, I thought Dodgeball, the RPG, was the worst idea for a game.
Well, no, when you thought that Dodgeball was the worst idea for an RPG, was that the reason you made the game, or?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Like, We said to ourselves, you know what? This is like the worst idea ever. Gotta do it. Absolutely.
Who doesn't want to play? Everybody loves dodgeball. And some people like role-playing games. So
there better be wrenches in dodgeball.
Of course. Because if you can dodge a wrench,
you can dodge a ball.
Exactly.
You know, I have a worse idea for a game. If you want a challenge, extreme house painting.
Ooh,
sure.
House painting.
Yeah, exactly. It's just accurately painting the entire house. Like you can have a board, and the board is just the house.
Or
art with different colors, paint.
I'm just gonna tell my friends to come over, and we're gonna play extreme house painting, the role playing game, and give them some paint.
Oh, because it's actually like a LARP.
It's an improv game.
It's a live action role play. You get a paint roller and paint, and you see how many points you can get based on how much coverage you accurately get on the side of the house. That's a great idea. That's like augmenting your life as a game. Everything you do, like getting experience points for doing everything. That should be an app on your freaking phone.
Ugh. It will be now.
It'll be now, folks. I need an app that's like an augmented reality so that, okay, you got out of bed. Congratulations, 2 experience points. Thank you. When do I level up? I need to know. You got in your car and got to work successfully. 5 XP. Thank you. And then you are your own PC character.
You didn't put your junk on Facebook. 2 experience points.
Yeah, I feel like it's more that you might not get experience points for doing something, for avoiding to do something bad, but you don't lose experience points or health points. You should have health.
Lose 50 experience.
Either your social stat. There should be a lot of sliders for this game. You need to have like your social. You have to have your psychological. You have to have your health, and you lose them if you do stupid things.
You choose to not Instagram pictures of your butt. You get to keep your job.
Yeah, job successfully maintained for 1 more day. Congratulations. I feel like the more I'm thinking about this, it really feels like H.P. Lovecraft just made this damn game. You slowly lose your sanity and everything that you hold dear by doing this. But then again, that's kind of what a cell phone is now that I think about it. Yeah. Okay. So, you know, Dodgeball, the RPG, just, you know, light at the end of the tunnel is, as we have now found out, not the worst game idea.
For those of you out there who thought it was, you were wrong.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
You were wrong because you know what? You never talked to me. If you had talked to me for 5 minutes.
You should not talk to Nathan for 5 minutes.
I'm the guy who came up with Metamorphin Power Players.
See? With the art, by the way, for Dodgeball, the role-playing game, is stupendous.
Really?
Who'd have thunk it?
Is it reminiscent of the movie and or game?
No, it's reminiscent of the Jetsons.
Oh, well, that's even better. I love that. That's great. For a second, I thought it might be like the informative video that Patches did during the movie.
And we went the 50s sci-fi route.
You can't go wrong with the 50s sci-fi route for practically anything.
Right?
That's great for every... I mean, that just harkens back to like thinking of like Fallout. Fallout has that great like 50s deco art style for so much of what they do, that retro style, and the game's so much better for it. If they had done like hyper realistic Pip-Boy,
yeah, it just wouldn't have worked.
No, it really wouldn't.
People probably would have played the game, but I don't think it would have. It would have been just lost in the thousands of other games.
Right.
I think it really is one of the things that helped it become its own.
Yeah. If they didn't have those little the fake PSAs that they did for the game coming in, people would be like, Fallout. Okay, sure. I need to have the little Pip-Boy in an animation explain to me why strength is an important stat.
Exactly. Sometimes the visual representation of a game really sets it apart. And sometimes you make dodgeball the role-playing game and you don't need to set yourself apart.
Yeah. Sell me on charisma. Tell me why that's important. Is there a charisma stat in Dodgeball, the RPG?
Yes.
Okay. Because then maybe you can charm the other team.
Exactly. It uses the very similar. It uses the base system from Teddy Bear Island and We Hunt Bugs. So it's the same basic system off of those games.
Right. Okay. So I can play a Fluffamancer in Dodgeball.
Theoretically, you could cross over. You could play a Fluffamancer.
Okay. That's good.
You could play a Nixie Fluffamancer in outer space. Because
now, if that's the case, does that mean that I get to take control of the mascots?
Yes.
Teams.
But you gotta look out for the dodgeballs aren't stuffed.
The dodgeballs aren't stuffed, but if you have those crazy mascots on the side, they're in the big furry costumes. I could take control of them.
Right, and you could swallow somebody's soul. I mean, besides the person that's in the suit, because they don't have one.
You know, it's better for you than that protein powder that they keep trying to sell you on for reasons. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, hey, you got to keep up your strength when you're dodgeballing.
That's right.
Yeah. Yep. Always a good thought. Just the more you know, that's where we need the more you know.
That's where you got to keep up your strength while dodgeballing.
Yeah, exactly. If you happen to be a mascot at a dodgeball event, don't let a Fluffamancer steal your soul and eat it for their own nutrition. The more you know, and the rainbow comes over. Yeah. And so if you needed any more reasons not to be a sports mascot, there's one more.
There you are, because the Fluffamancer will swallow your soul.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I feel like here's a great idea. Here's a crossover for you. Pat, I'm going to give you the idea of the day.
All right.
Okay. It's Dodgeball the RPG, but you do the We Hunt Bugs thing, and essentially we turn it into Space Jam. It's it's just Space Jam.
Space Jam the role-playing game.
Space Jam the role-playing game, and the Monstars are now bugs.
I like it.
Right?
You'd have to call it Cosmic Jelly.
Cosmic Jelly, because I don't want to get sued.
Cosmic Jelly, the RPG. We officially came up with a worse idea for a game.
Ooh.
Enjoy. On that note...
I got nothing. I'm sorry.
So, Pat, any other things that, since you're working on a million different things, anything else coming down in the future that you'd like to tell us about? Or
Lastly, I guess our friends over again at This End Up Publications are going to have a couple of games coming out I helped with. I did most of the writing for a game called How I Survived the Apocalypse in Cincinnati, and Ninja in a Box, I believe, is the other one. So,
oh, very nice.
Those will probably both be out early next year as well, too.
Yeah. So. Yeah,
I don't have enough side projects. I always have to try to
work. Of course not.
Right. How exactly are you supposed to survive the apocalypse if you're already in Cincinnati?
You're going to have to get the game to find out.
You wouldn't really notice, would you?
Nah, that's what I was thinking.
It's going to be a Rift-style post-apocalyptic Earth mixed with Simpsons-esque art. So far for the test adventure, it's going to be come along with the book. The main bad guy is Wilbur, the interdimensional mantity. So
okay,
that's how serious of a game it's going to be.
Yeah,
take it from there.
At least it's not a cosmic axolotl.
Well, that's for the expansion.
I think you might run into some issues with that one, too.
Dang it.
So now, wait a second. So are we actually saying canonically that Springfield was based on Cincinnati?
Sure, let's go with that.
Okay.
There was a game theorist that's actually, I think, based in Washington.
Oh, did they
actually? Sorry, film theory. Film theory. Matt Pat, they did some research. I think it's either Idaho or Washington. It's one of those states up there.
Oh, okay.
They're pretty sure. The Simpsons,
I think they had to do Washington because it's a coastal city.
Right. I think that was probably it. There's a thing. You can watch it.
Yes.
The irony is, there was actually an episode of The Simpsons where they were doing like The Simpsons behind the scenes. It was supposed to be like Behind the Music, but they did an episode that was just The Simpsons, like Behind the Music. And in that, like at the very end, they actually just say what state they're in.
If I remember correctly, it's one of the few states that doesn't have a Springfield in it. I think that was the...
Right, that was like the thing to explain that, you know what, folks? It's not a real place.
Yes.
I mean, to be fair, there was, I believe, an episode where they were on top of like a mountain. They were looking over four different states, and one was like Maine, one was like Nevada. Yeah. So, I mean.
Yeah. That's a full retrospectus on Orcs Unlimited.
I just remembered. Sorry. We have currently, and we'll have more, if you go to shapeways.com under Orcs Unlimited, we have the first of the Escape from Teddy Bear Island miniatures up, and they will fill out all 12 of the original plushies from the first Escape from Teddy Bear Island, and they will work from there. So if you want some messed up miniatures either for your Escape from Teddy Bear Island game, or you want to throw plushies into your existing D&D game, you can pop on over there and get some. They're pretty fantastic. They were brought into 3D from our friends over at Sky Relics, because I didn't know how to do it.
Oh, Derek Keith did it. Got it. I know Derek.
So they've been doing it. He's been in his off hours, because he has as many as we do. He's been helping us get some, and we're going to put them on. People can get there. We started with the bear holder, which is a pretty twisted looking miniature. So if you get a chance to get over there and grab yourself one, go right ahead, and then we're going to go to Zombears and go on down the road. Mm-hmm. So we should have a fun list of those over at Shapeways here shortly.
Nice. Now, that does bring up a question for me, at least, is how can I create a Fluffomancer out of the existing D&D archetypes?
I hate to admit this, because I always get like branded a heretic. I'm not a D&D player.
Right.
When we do play, we usually play first edition, old school Advanced Dungeons and Dragons.
Ooh. Well,
yeah,
that's too old school for my taste.
So I don't have the skills. I have been talking to a couple of people about doing some crossovers, so people would be able to bring the Teddy Bear Island monsters and characters over to a fifth edition setting, but I just don't have the expertise to do it. Between the other games and we play and writing games, fifth edition just has never been. I played a couple of times and I enjoy it, but Dungeons and Dragons isn't really, oddly enough, after writing a fantasy role playing game that's practically a Dungeons and Dragons ripoff, isn't actually my game. And
right.
So I don't have the expertise to actually write it well enough that I'd want to publish it. So we might have some friends and coworkers that may be helping us. So you might see some Teddy Bear Island stuff under somebody else's name, and it might be a fifth edition expansion.
I see. Okay. Yeah. Cause I'm trying to wrap my head around fifth edition right now for some things that I'm supposed to be doing. But I kind of feel like there should be a point, Alex, just keep this in your noggin, that at some point it would be kind of neat if we did a stream and we tried to run like first edition D&D.
Yeah, no, we're not doing that. First of all, we'd have to get a hold of files for first edition. Second of all, someone willing to run first edition. Third of all, I don't feel like learning Thaco. Thank you very much.
Was Thaco in first edition?
Yes.
I thought Thaco
was the original from AD&D first edition. Good old two hit armor class zero, in case you didn't know what Thaco stood for.
I know. It's I always think of it as like armor class, but in reverse.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
I think I've mentioned
the lower my number, the better.
I think I mentioned before that we started with the Palladium system when I started role-playing, so as opposed to Dungeons & Dragons. And I'm more of a sci-fi role-player anyway, so we just never... It just has never been my game, so I just don't have the expertise. But it's been a thought.
Also, the other thing there, Nathan, is as much as fun as First Ed might be to play, how do you feel about your class being Elf?
I wouldn't probably use Elf as a class, though.
Well, Elf was a class, I'm pretty sure.
Yes.
So I could be a human Elf?
No.
No?
You would just be an Elf.
The other races were their own classes. They weren't races. So you were a human, whatever, or an elf, a dwarf, halfling.
Oh.
I think there was something else, but I can't remember what it was.
So you can just be an elf?
Yeah, you're just an elf. Huh. You're pretty much a fighter magic user at that point.
Oh, okay. So if you're an elf, that's all you can be. You're just elfy.
Elf-ish. You don't get to pick a class. You're just an elf.
And I've never seen anybody play D&D First Edition long enough. They have very low level caps, so you can only be a certain level elf. I've rarely seen a D&D game go beyond fourth or fifth level, so...
Yeah, well, you know, that does kind of lend credence to the idea that maybe they weren't the biggest Lord of the Rings fans, because in Lord of the Rings, the elves are, like, the best at everything.
That's because they're pompous, and they're old.
And they're old, yeah. That kind of comes with the territory. Hey, you know what? We could even go older school and do chainmail.
There you go.
How are you going to play a miniature game?
Is that a miniature game?
Yes.
Nathan.
Oh, I don't know. I just know that chainmail came before Dungeons and Dragons. Look, my limited knowledge it makes me interesting only to a point, Alex. Okay? That should have been the subtitle for the show. My limited knowledge only makes me interesting to a point.
Ta-da! Dun, da, 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 da. Where's the that damn star when I need it?
Yeah, exactly.
The more you don't know.
That should be my catchphrase from now on. Anytime people like, what does Nathan do? Oh, his limited knowledge is only interesting to a point.
You should get business cards.
Damn it, and I just got new business cards. I gotta make another batch. Alex, question for you. How do you feel about, like, unicorns unlimited?
Unlimited amounts of unicorns? That's too many.
There is no such thing. There is no such thing as too many unicorns.
I mean, which one is going to be the loveliest of all then, Nathan? Seriously.
They all share first place.
That's not going to happen.
Except the ones that are mimics. If they're a mimicorn, do not count. Anywho, I want to thank Pat McNary from Orcs Unlimited, not Unicorns Unlimited, but Negative. Orcs Unlimited. That's right. From Orcs Unlimited for being on the show. Thank you, Pat.
Yay, thanks for letting me on.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, you're welcome to come on the show anytime, even if it means crashing other people on the show.
Oh, that's
push that'll be fun.
Get out of here.
Just push him off.
Push Nathan off for me once in a while.
Anyway, I feel like if you aren't on the show at least once a year, we've missed out, because it is Orcs Unlimited. So we have to have unlimited amounts of orcs.
Exactly. We have unlimited amounts of games. As long as I keep getting hit on the head.
Yeah. Smack. Yeah. Head smacks unlimited is really what shit.
I guess.
We're just going to start a second segment on our website. And it will be Idea Hour with Pat McNair.
Exactly. I got hit on the head this week. Guess what?
Ideas from the Trauma Ward.
Exactly.
It's good. If anyone would like to find out more information about Nine Card Dungeon or the other projects over at Orcs Unlimited, where could they go on the internet?
You can always visit us at orcsunlimited.com. We are on Facebook at Orcs Unlimited and good old Twitter. I spend a lot of time on Twitter because it's always fun. Support at Orcs Unlimited. So that's probably the best way. We're going to be on Kickstarter October 31st. Come over and see what we're doing over there. We'll get this game out the door. We're projecting March of 2019.
Nice.
As soon as we close, we're going to get our funds and start printing. So the game the files are already there. So very quick turnaround this one.
Beautiful. Yeah. And hey, low buy-in. And you know, if the Kickstarter goes well, we can look into that 90 card expansion.
Ooh, gotta love the 90 card dungeon.
Yeah, since we're always looking for bigger game worlds, to just have 10 times the landscape. Now, Alex, if anyone was interested in more Delve-related matters, where could they go?
You can find more information about Delve over at delvecast.com.
That's right, you certainly can. Delve-related things and orbital-related things and attempting to play and all the other things that we're doing. And while you are there, why not check out our Patreon? We have a little banner right in the corner when you first get on the site, and you can go over and look at all the exclusive content that you can get, including the unedited, unabridged episodes in their entirety, and some other special pieces that are just exclusive to the website. You can find the show on all sorts of podcast apps like iTunes and Google Play. Please rate and review and subscribe when you go, and you can also follow us on Twitter. I am at Citanium.
I am at EXP Limited, and the show is at Delve Podcast.
And it's also at Orcs Unlimited, correct?
Yay! Yes.
Yay! At Orcs Unlimited, to follow along on all of the news that's fit to print or type, or whatever you do with a screen. What do you do with? Is that technically typing if you're doing it on the
tap? Maybe tap.
Tapping all the news that's fit to tap.
Freezing.
Oh, Sterling Archer, you're welcome. I just gave you that one. So anyway, I think we've gotten as many cards, especially our lucky ones, that we are going to enjoy. What is our lucky card?
There's 9 of them.
There's 9 of them. And thank you so much for everybody joining us. It's been wonderful. I hope that you have a lovely day and do not get animated or eaten by a Fluffamancer. If you do, for instance, see like a homicidal teddy bear that wants to stuff you and animate you, do not go near it. And yeah, exactly.
Sound advice.
You know, we are good for very few things, but you know, telling you to avoid homicidal teddy bears, that's one of them. We'll see you next time on Delve. Yeah, that's all I got.
Toodles.
Bye.
Bye.
Now, Alex, if anyone was interested in more Delve-related matters, where could they go?
You can find Delve at delvepodcast.com.
No, you can't.